Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, good. You can hear me.
Yes.
Excellent. Welcome, church. Welcome back. We call this In-Gathering Sunday. The choir's back. Josh is back at that lovely organ console. You are back. How wonderful it is for us to begin yet another program year here at the Presbyterian Church of Lawrenceville. So wherever you are, here in the meeting house, joining us online, we're glad you're here. Now, if you are someone who is new to our worshiping community, if you're here in the meeting house, you might find in front of you a thing called a Connect card. If you would fill that out and put it in the plate as it comes by, that way we can stay in touch with you. Those Connect cards are for all of us in worship to make known any prayer concern that is to be lifted up by our prayer team around the piano after worship. Simply write that on the Connect card and put it in the plate as it comes by. If you're joining us online and you're with us for the first time, put your name in the chat so we can greet you. And the chat feature is available at any time to make known prayer concerns. Now, if you're here in the meeting house with us today, we really hope that you will indeed join us for a time of fellowship in our fellowship center for several reasons. First of all, as part of our in-gathering festivities, we have bagels and other wonderful things like schmear and I think probably jelly and wonderful stuff to put on your bagels. So if that weren't incentive enough to join together, there's also, of course, an opportunity for good conversation and to learn more about how to participate here at the Presbyterian Church of Lawrenceville. We're having what we call a participation palooza. So people representing various parts of our mission, groups and teams in our church mission will be out on the table, and you can talk to them about how to get involved. So please do check that out. And then at 11:30 approximately, we'll be having a report back from our youth about the mission trip, and that's going to happen in the lounge. So a lot of stuff going on today in church. Please join us after worship for that. Okay, a few announcements before we begin our worship service. Next Sunday is our picnic. So free food. We do ask you to bring, maybe if you can, something according to the instructions in the bulletin. Please check that out. So that's after worship next Sunday. Thank you very much to our deacons for providing some wonderful food for our picnic next Sunday. Tonight, we begin once again our monthly Teze service. It's on a different night than usual because it's usually the first Sunday of the month. But that's a really wonderful way to end your weekend and slide into the work week with a very meditative mode of worship that is Teze worship in the chapel at 7:30. So a few other items, save the date, 325th gala on November 18, donations to the flea market. And finally, I wanted to also point out the form that you found in your bulletin. This is hopefully not an excuse not to come to our participation palooza. But if somehow you can't make it, and certainly if you can, we'd love to know how you might want to serve. That's another way that you might indicate the way that you can get involved, you want to get involved here at the Presbyterian Church of Lawrenceville. You can put that in the plate as it comes by. You can leave that in your pew. You can take it to the office. But please take a moment to review that bright red form called Help Wanted. Okay, that's all the news that's fit to print so far this Sunday, but I want to, we end with a moment for mission, and I'm going to call forward Sherry Ahlers, who is our brand new director of the Lawrenceville Presbyterian Preschool, and I can't tell you how delighted we are that she has found her way. Yeah, go ahead, come on up here. Yeah, and so she's going to tell us a little bit about the Lawrenceville Presbyterian Preschool, which has been going since, I believe, 1960, something like that.
I'll let you know. Okay, good morning. I'm here today to lift up the Lawrenceville Presbyterian Preschool as we celebrate its beginning on September 13th. The preschool was started in 1961 as a place for young children and families to grow. Preschool has been downstairs operating for 62 years. Wow. This week, so many children and families have been part of the preschool. Please raise your hand if you ever attended the preschool as a child. See, we have some people here. Yay. If you had a child or children that attended the preschool, raise your hand. Awesome. If you were ever a teacher or staff member. If you were ever a board member. Yep, keep your eye on there. or you have ever volunteered down there. Anyone? Yay. If you've ever been on a tour or visited. Okay, and those of you who did not raise your hand, I would love to invite you to come down and take a tour. This school year we'll be operating 1 3- to 5-year-old class called the Doves. So you'll see us, I know you've heard the words chickadees and ducklings and puffins, but this and owls, this year we're gonna be the Doves. We have two returning lovely, lovely teachers, Miss Annabelle and Miss Jamie. And we invite you to come down anytime to see the space, take a tour, or arrange a visit to read or spend some time with our Doves downstairs. So please join me this year in lifting up the children and families and teachers by sharing some back-to-school blessings and wishes on the big yellow chart paper that's right at the top of the stairs. There's some markers there. If you could leave a message for the children and families and teachers, we would very much appreciate that. And today, I'll be at a table inviting you to take a Dove to purchase an item that you would like to donate to the preschool. So things like boxes of Kleenex or a bag of sand. We've already purchased that. It would be a monetary donation. So come and find me, and I'll have some Doves for you to take, sort of like how we do Angel Tree. Okay. Thank you very much, and I hope to see you downstairs. Thank you.
Let's see if this is on. Yes, it is. Good morning. This morning, we will be commissioning our Princeton Theological Seminary intern, Patrick Alfieri Sunday. So I'd like to invite him up so he can introduce himself. This year, Patrick will be interning with youth ministry, but I'm sure we will see him in all different aspects of the life and work of the church. So Patrick, would you be willing to share maybe just a little bit about who you are and what you're looking forward to this year?
Hello, I'm Patrick Alfieri Sunday. I am a second-year student at Princeton Theological Seminary. I'm here today with my partner, Emma Claire, who conveniently teaches right next door at the Lawrenceville School. And this school year, I'm going to be helping Alicia and the youth ministry team run programs for our young people. And I am so excited to share with them the love of Christ.
Welcome, Patrick. And we're going to commission Patrick today, as we normally do. And this time I'm going to remember to give some instructions. So you'll see the responsive commissioning there in your order of worship. And when we flip to the second page, it's not you that's going to start, it's Patrick. He's got a question for you that we'll respond to. Okay, so let's, and then we'll join together in a corporate prayer. So let's commission Patrick together. Who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love?
I will, with God's help.
Do you welcome the responsibility of this service because you are determined to follow the Lord Jesus, to love neighbors, and to work for the reconciling of the world?
I do. I will, with God's help. Will you support me and encourage me in this ministry?
We will. Faith in God and baptism between us, and by your Holy Spirit, you are working in our lives, empowering us to live a life worthy of our calling. We thank you for truly being Patrick for this time and place. Establish him in your truth and guide him by your Holy Spirit, that in your service he may grow in faith, hope, and love. Amen.
Well, welcome, Patrick, and we invite everybody, as you participate in our participation palooza and fellowship time, to greet Patrick and to introduce yourselves to him.
Please join me in the call to worship as it is printed in your bulletin. Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I will observe it to the end.
Give me understanding, that I may keep your law and observe it with my whole heart.
Lead me in the path of your commandments, for I delight in it. Let us worship God together.
Amid the countless things that human beings cannot fully comprehend about God, there stands this. God so loves us. God bathes us with grace and feeds us with mercy and forgives us our sins. Confident in the love of God, let us pray together. Lord God, while we were still slaves to sin, you died for our salvation. Yet we still worship the false gods of the world, forgetting that you are Lord. Loving worldly wealth, we have not loved you with our whole heart, nor loved our neighbors as ourselves. Trusting worldly strength, we have not trusted your word, not followed the world made your word made flesh. Forgiving by worldly norms, we have not shown mercy to others. We, as you have shown mercy to us, forgive us yet again, we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Friends, I invite you, as you are able, to please join me in standing in body and or in spirit as we hear the good news. Setting aside the works of darkness, we as people of faith live in the light of Christ together. Gathered this day in Christ's name, he is surely among us, full of grace and full of truth. And so, friends, this morning, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. We are lifted up to new life. Thanks be to God. Amen. Adults, you may be seated, and children, you're invited to come forward for our time with children. Good morning. It's so good to see everybody. I bet there's nobody here who is excited to see me as I am to see you. Ava, you're as excited to see me as I am to see you? All right, we got somebody vying for my favorite. Nobody? Nobody's going to fight that? Nobody wants to be excited to see me, huh? Well, I'm super excited to see you all this morning. Thanks for being here. It's so good to see you. I hope everybody had the best summer. Today, we have a kind of special scripture reading that I want to talk to you about. But before that, I wanted to share a little bit of a story from another scripture reading as a reason why I want to start by saying I love the Bible. And here's why. This week, we shared on Facebook a trivia question about a Bible story. And there's a man named Elijah who was bald. And there are a couple of kids that made fun of him for being bald. They called him Baldy. This is actually in the Bible, folks. And do you know what? Can you guess what Elisha did to punish the kids who called him Baldy? Yeah, Ava. What do you think he did? He prayed to God for help. That's a good guess. Anybody else want to take a guess? I bet you won't figure this one out. He maybe should have prayed to God for help, but instead, he called out some bears to eat the children. That's really in the Bible, I promise. It's one of my favorite stories, because it's so crazy, right? So who's excited to see me now? right? But Ava makes a really good point, because those children were not nice to Elijah, or excuse me, to Elisha, and maybe Elisha could have prayed to God for help, right? So our scripture reading this morning, Jesus tells us and his disciples, if anybody is mean to you, or if anybody hurts you, you should call bears to eat them. Do you think that's what Jesus says? Probably not. You think so? Jesus says that you should first go to that person who is mean to you and tell them that they hurt your feelings. Right? And if they don't listen, you should try it again. And if they don't listen, then you can gather a couple of people from the church and you could confront them. And you should, but there are some points that I want to make here, right? How many of you have ever had your feelings hurt by somebody? Has anybody ever been mean to you, you know? And what is our tendency? Do we want to be mean back? Sometimes we do, right? Sometimes we wish they would be eaten by bears. But Jesus says there's something really important here. And the whole point is, there's two points I want you to remember here. When somebody hurts you, we can't control their actions, right? But we can control our own actions. And so Jesus says you should first go to them and tell them that they've hurt you, right? And that's important. That's kind of a hard job sometimes. And so there's an important message there. We can't control other people's actions, but we can control our own actions. And we know that Jesus wants us to love our friends, to love our neighbors, and even people who hurt us, right? And so the goal is not so that person who hurt us gets hurt back, but so that forgiveness can happen. And you know what I love about, have you ever heard the Bible? This is from our scripture reading this morning. Wherever two or three are gathered in my name, there I am with them also. Have you ever heard that before? So that passage comes from this. And the idea is Jesus knows that it's hard to forgive people. Jesus knows that it's hard to do that. And so he says, I'm going to be with you, and I'm going to help you and give you the strength to do it, right? And so that's why it's important, even sometimes when we want people to be eaten by bears. Sometimes doing the hard work of forgiving each other and having conversations is what really Jesus wants from us. And Jesus gives us the strength to do it, and Jesus is with us, and so that we can do it, right? What if everybody was eaten by bears? That wouldn't be any fun, right? Maybe initially, but not long term. Then what would the bears do? Yeah, Ava. Until there's no people left. That wouldn't be fun. So the whole, this, it gets to the good point, right? If everybody's eaten by bears, something's not going well. But if everybody is forgiving each other and living together and, you know, can you imagine hanging out with your friends all the time? It's sort of this vision that God is trying to create for us. And so we're called to work towards that. It's tough, but Jesus is with us, all right? So let's pray together. And we're not going to pray for bears, but we're going to pray for God's help. All right, let's pray together. God, we thank you for your love for us. Help us to show that love to others, even when it's hard. And thanks for being here with us to help us do that. God, we thank you for these kids and for their ministry here among us at this church. And we know that we are truly the church together. We thank you, and it's in your son's name that we pray. Amen. All right. I'm going to have you guys all stand up. And after our blessing, if you're headed to Sunday school, you can head to Sunday school. If you're heading back to your seat, you can do that. But before that, we want to do our normal blessing. And so who comes first? I can never remember. The adults are going to say, and kiddos, you're going to turn around and shout back. All right.
So while the children are leaving the meeting house, I'd invite you to turn to page 895 in your pew Bible. We're going to be focusing today on Matthew chapter 18, the first part of that chapter. And I'll be reading the first half of the lesson, and Kyle will be reading the second half. Let us listen for God's word. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Who is greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" He called a child whom he put among them and said, "Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever becomes humble like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. If any of you cause one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for you if a great millstone were fastened around your neck and you were drowned in the depth of the sea. Woe to the world because of things that cause sin. Such things are bound to come, but woe to the one through whom they come. If your hand or your foot causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life maimed or lame than to have two hands or two feet and be thrown into the eternal fire. If your eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into the hell of fire. Take care that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I tell you, in heaven, their angels continually see the face of my Father in heaven. What do you think? If a shepherd has 100 sheep and one of them has gone astray, does he not leave the 99 on the mountains and go in search of the one that went astray? And if he finds it, truly I tell you, he rejoices over it more than the other 99 that never went astray. So it is not the will of your Father in heaven that one of these little ones should be lost."
Continuing now in verse 15. "If your brother or your sister sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If you are listened to, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If that person refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything that you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, I hope that you were able to follow along in your Bible, because there's a lot there in Matthew chapter 18, which I happen to think is one of the most important chapters of our entire Bible, because it gives us a picture of Jesus' intention for the church. And so let's dive in. We're going to do some careful textual study of the first part of Matthew chapter 18. So at the beginning of the chapter, we read that Jesus is kind of beating down an argument happening among his disciples. Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Now keep in mind that this chapter happens after Matthew's narration of the Transfiguration, that kind of sound and light show that happened on a mountaintop, and some of the heroes of the Old Testament appear with Jesus. And then Jesus comes down from the mountain and heals a young boy with epilepsy, and the disciples must be thinking, "Man, this guy is a superhero. We're going to be famous. This regime that Jesus is creating, the kingdom of heaven, is happening." And so the conversation must have drifted to who is going to be most famous in the kingdom of heaven. And so Jesus, to answer the question, calls over a little kid. And we know, you know, kids liked hanging out with Jesus, so he calls over a little kid and he points to the child and he says, "This one is greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And it said, unless you turn and humble yourself and become like this kid, you're not going to get it. You're not going to be part of the kingdom of heaven. And he said, in fact, if any of you cause one of these little ones, and that's an important phrase in the chapter we'll look at in a moment, if any of you cause one of these little ones to stumble, it'd be better for you to be wearing cement shoes and take a boat ride into the middle of the Atlantic, in modern terms, he says. Any of you trying to climb that ladder to glory somehow causes one of these little children to stumble, it will be bad for you. So what does Jesus mean by this phrase, little ones? He uses it three times, the beginning of chapter 18 of Matthew. So we might think what Jesus means is literally this little child. It calls forward to be a sort of object lesson. But I think interpreters of this passage would say that there's a larger category of people that corresponds to this phrase, little ones. And certainly it includes children, but children are exemplars of the most vulnerable in society, the least powerful in society, subject to the will of others, often abused. And so little ones are people who believe with a kind of innocence and pure heart, but also they represent those who are outside the realm of the respectable, the 99. They are the people who are, as Jesus refers to them in other places in Scripture, the last and the least and the lost. And so this beginning part of Matthew 18 ends with that famous parable, Jesus telling the story of the lost sheep. He said, what shepherd wouldn't go after one lost sheep and leave the 99 on the mountainside? And of course, there are a lot of shepherds who would do that, right? You know, I mean, that's how the world works. The utilitarian math of how people usually behave is we've got to write that one off. That one doesn't matter. That it's its own fault for wandering off. So we have to. That's not the kind of society that Jesus is building, the kind of kingdom that Jesus is establishing. It's about seeking those people who are on the outside, the last and the least and the lost. I think this scripture is very appropriate for us to focus on this, we call it Ingathering Sunday, people coming back from the inevitable phenomenon of scattering during the summer. And maybe you had some downtime and back fully at work. And, you know, it's an appropriate time to ask the question, what is it about my life? This precious life that I've been given, what's it for? Am I here just to make money off of others? Draw on my retirement and eat, drink, and be merry, maximize pleasure and minimize pain? Is that why I'm here? Or am I part of something greater, some greater purpose for my life? That's what this is, church. A society that trades in transcendence and human meaning and purpose, that's the something greater. And today the question is, what part will you play? What part do you play in that something greater? Well, I want to begin that conversation with maybe a bit of cheerleading and some celebrating. I want to talk a little bit about this church and where I have seen this church evolve. I think this church is becoming a Matthew 18 church. Very similar to what we already are, a Matthew 25 church. Matthew 25, when was it that we saw you naked and clothe you? When was it that we saw you hungry and feed you? When was it that we saw you in prison and visit you? The Matthew 18 church is a church dedicated to reaching out to the little ones, to the ones on the outside, a church that's passionate about mission, that exists for mission. And I think I'm seeing that happen here, that God is doing that among us, and I'm very convicted of that. And so here's some examples, I think, that we should celebrate. an organization called WorkWell. Most of you are familiar with it, an organization that was so hard to get going, trust me. A nonprofit organization now fully separate from the church, dedicated to giving job training to people coming from prison. And I know that my colleagues on that board are sick of hearing me say this, but this is my sermon that I repeat quite often, that the work product, the primary work product of that program is not just job skills, it's community. And that's what makes it so very different. It's transformative relationships. People who are suburban folk worried about where their kid's going to college, hanging out with people who can't even get their license back because they have so many unpaid tickets. That's what it's about, relationships and the spirit of Christ that dwells among people, helping each other. So WorkWell, but refugee ministry, we just began that, and boy, did we dive into it. That parable of a shepherd focusing effort on one is probably apropos here, because you have no idea just how much help is required for our partner family to get them established here in the United States, strangers in a strange land. And we could certainly use all the help we can get with that. But it's not just about helping people and being do-gooders. It's about relationships that are transformative. It's about learning what it's like for somebody who is from so far away making their way in a strange place, and what it's like for so many others who didn't make it here, who are refugees and who are suffering in other parts of the world. Our Haiti ministry, we've been in it for 30 years. And just because we can't travel there doesn't mean we haven't been helping Pastor Luke and the people of Haiti. Trust me, behind the scenes, we're doing everything we can to support him and that ministry. Our fledgling community center, the Community Well, and I hope that we are becoming a church that's passionate about the wellness of our community, the wellness of people here, but also mostly the people who are not here. I hope we're about the dream that we're transforming this very place, renewing it, so that when people walk into a community center and a church, they have the understanding that people care about me and my wellness of body and mind and spirit through a counseling center, through wellness services that they will find here. A food pantry, it's a little box out there, but you have no idea how much food goes through that thing every day. It has to be restocked. That's a significant part of our mission and our ministry. But these are just a few examples of newer things that we're doing. Don't get me wrong, the core of our mission is proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ in what we do and what we say. The taproot of our work and mission is ministry, is worship. It's the day-to-day, week-to-week stuff we do, Sunday school, teaching, all of that. But I do have to say, I believe God is doing a new thing among us in enabling us to understand. And I think people are sort of understanding that this is a church that's in mission, that's doing things to be relevant to the community around it. I think we're becoming known as a church that is reaching out to little ones. Now I want to go back to that question. Who is Jesus talking about when he uses that phrase, little ones? There's a bit of a danger here, I think, because you need to answer that question with, oh, it's easy to see the people given the ministries and missions I just mentioned, we can understand who those little ones are. They're people coming from prison. They're refugees. They're hungry people. They're the people in Haiti. And not on that list is me. Or you. And that's a mistake. Remember at the beginning of this chapter, Jesus calls this kid over and he says, unless you humble yourself and become like this little one, you're not going to get it. So we always need to include ourselves in that category, little ones, because that's who we're trying to be. We're trying to be least in the kingdom of heaven and therefore the greatest. The Indian theologian D.T. Niles once wrote, one of my favorite quotes, the church is one beggar telling another beggar where to find bread. That's who we are. I will mention, too, that part of that mission is actually to help somebody else find bread here, maybe. Hopefully, through what we're doing, they will know we are Christians by our love, and some of them will end up in these pews. This is part of it, too, the mission called evangelism. But sometimes it means we have to ask people to come. I think that's something that we continue to need to explore. What does it mean to say, come on, join me here? Join us here. I'm having an experience of the Holy Spirit somehow through my work here at the Presbyterian Church of Lawrenceville. And so, my friends, we need all the help we can get as we become a Matthew 18 church, as God is creating us to be a Matthew 18 church. So after worship, as I said before, I'd really implore you not to go home. I mean, grab a bagel. How hard is that? Come and join us and learn more about the amazing array of things that we're doing in the name of Jesus Christ. But there's a fairly significant group of people in this church doing a lot of work. But we need a lot of people to do just a bit of the work. That's what we're aiming at. So if you've got an hour and a half once a month to give a ride to our refugee partner family, that would be awesome. If you have one Saturday a week to go to the mentoring program at Workwell, fantastic. If you can restock the food pantry, if you can be a liturgist once a quarter, if you can teach Sunday school, we need your help. As we seek to become, as God is creating us to be, a Matthew 18 church. All right, that's the first part of the text. And I have a couple things to say about the second part. So bear with me. I still have a couple more minutes left, all right? I love your attention. But this second part is so important, too. The first part's about the mission of the church. And the second part of this text that we heard is about the discipline of the church. And that's often thought of as a kind of dirty word. But to be disciplined is so important. It's about treating everybody as a little one. We're all loved little ones in this community, this motley crew. But as we do that, as we try to treat everybody with respect, as if they are Christ in our midst, we have to understand that that's not always going to happen. I mean, Jesus knew that we can have the delusion that in the beginning the church was, they all got together on Sunday and sang Kumbaya and everybody got along perfectly and shared their goods equally and all of that. It didn't happen. The church is as human an institution as any other. My first job out of college, I worked at the national headquarters of the Presbyterian Church in a building they call the God Box. There are all these denominational headquarters in the Upper West Side of New York City. And I thought, man, you know, at the national headquarters of the church, those people must be really holy. I was quickly disabused of that. It's just as human an institution as any other. So we need discipline. We need guidelines. A whole one-third of the Book of Orders is called the Book of Discipline. So we have rules for how we deal with conflict. And Jesus gives us an outline. It's a kind of idealized version of how we deal with conflict in the church. And these rules are important not just for life in church, but life in general. Maybe your work, other realms of your life. So really quickly, three steps for dealing with conflict. Number one, really hard to do. You have a beef with somebody, go to them. Not easy to do. But what is easy to do? I mean, let's face it, to talk about that person. So I have a dispute with Joe, and I'm talking with Fred here, and I say to Fred, can you believe what Joe did? And then Fred says, I let me tell you about Joe. What a jerk. And then you're totally bonding over how horrible Joe is, but you're not talking to Joe. And I mean, this very simple phenomenon can toxify churches, businesses. I've seen it happen, and knock wood, it's not so bad here, I don't think, but I've seen congregations where that's toxified life and the culture of that church. But let's say you can't work it out with Joe, just one-to-one, person-to-person. There's step two, which is harder. Step one, hard. Step two, harder. You invite somebody else to come and help you deal with that dispute. And that's hard because you're giving up your power. You're admitting something that you're weak, you're too weak to solve this on your own. And so you ask somebody else to help you solve it. I was in a conflict with somebody in my church in Palo Alto. And it was actually over who gets to serve on the nominating committee. And we could not work it out. It was very difficult, and so we decided, let's find somebody from the presbytery to help us work it out. Which was hard, because, you know, pastors, we're supposed to be able to, you know, we have the power, and we should be able to figure this out and make it happen. We couldn't. And actually, that helped. And one of the things I guess I have some pride about is that we had a working relationship by the time I ended my ministry there. But let's say that doesn't work. The third option is why we have the Book of Discipline in our Constitution. The church deals with something that is toxifying and is affecting the life of everybody. And so I think one of the reasons the church is struggling is because often we don't have the courage to say no. Always we try to restore somebody who is being destructive, but when that doesn't happen, sometimes we have to say no. You're in the penalty box. You know, pastors, churches are so, have such a often terrible track record in saying, no, we will not tolerate this kind of behavior. And so we have to say goodbye. Always, though, seeking restoration. The text ends this way: if they don't listen to the church, treat them as a Gentile and a tax collector. And we're meant to think, where have we heard that before? Ah, how did Jesus treat those people? Right? So always this kind of justice and discipline is about restoration, never retribution. So, a Gentile and a tax collector. That sounds kind of like a little one to me. The kind of people we're always trying to include and restore. A Matthew 18 church. A church of lost and loved and humble little ones like you and me. Amen.
Remain standing in body and or in spirit as together we affirm our faith using the words that are printed there in your order of worship. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release to the captives.
teaching by word and deed and blessing the children, healing the sick, binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe the gospel. Unjustly condemned for blasphemy and sedition, Jesus was crucified, suffering the depths of human pain and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raised this Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, delivering us from death to life eternal. Amen. You may be seated. As we come now to a time of prayer, I'd like to remind you that in the pew rack in front of you are our Connect cards. Those are available to request prayer, and you can place those in the offering plates as they come along later in the service. And if you're with us online and feel comfortable doing so, you can ask and list your prayer requests there in the chat. Friends, let us pray together. God of grace, God of steadfast love, we do truly thank you for your commandments, which do order our life together. We thank you for calling us to live honorably with one another and to pray for your grace as we try to do all that you require of us. For we know that in some way, maybe it's grace, the way that we live together not only directs people to your grace and to your love, not only does it resemble something of what heaven is like, but in some mystical way it brings a piece of heaven here on earth. Increase in us, we pray, O God, the capacity to love you and our neighbors without reserve, and to love even those who harm us. Not half-heartedly, but with our whole hearts, O God, we bring before you the cares and the concerns and the joys that occupy our hearts and minds this day. We remember and we pray for those who are at odds with one another in families, in neighborhoods or offices, and even in the church. We pray for our nation and its leaders. We pray for all nations and for all people. We pray for anyone in the midst of internal or external struggles and conflicts. Teach us, O God, teach us to seek nonviolent ways toward resolution. Help us to speak the truth and to listen with understanding when perspectives are far apart. We pray for your love to bring peace into every troubled heart and place. We pray for those who have physical needs this morning, people who are hungry and thirsty, people who are exhausted by the demands of working or caregiving, people who are sick or undergoing surgery or live with chronic pain. Be relief, be rest, O God. We pray for those weighed down with the needs of heart and soul, a worry that keeps us awake at night, grief that accompanies us everywhere we go, depression that clouds us or an addiction that grips us. We lift all of these heavy burdens, O God, with the light and peace of your presence. Excuse me, lift all of these heavy burdens with the light and peace of your presence, we pray. Sustain us over the long journey toward health and give us trust in you, ourselves, and those who love us. We remember this morning the people of Hawaii, the people of Marrakesh, the people of Haiti. Be present with them. Be present with those who are seeking to help, provide rescue, support, healthcare, needs, restructuring, policing, structure. And God, remember not only our cares this morning, but also our joys, a birthday celebrated, an anniversary enjoyed, new beginnings, a baby born, a child adopted, a family found, the start of a new school year, a new job, a new relationship. We thank you, O God, for the gift of laughter and for enduring friendships and cherished memories. We give you thanks for this church, for each one gathered here in person and online, for those who can't be with us this morning, for the many ways in which you call us together into this beloved community to share our gifts and our love, our talents, our resources together. We give you thanks that there is always a new beginning, a way where there is no way, hope beyond hope, and life beyond death. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, Paul's counsel to the church in Rome was to owe no one anything except to love one another. And so come, let us love one another here and beyond by sharing what we have been given so that the needs are met and the gospel is proclaimed. As the ushers come forward and come around, if you're gathered here in the meeting house, you can place your gift in the offering plates. If you're with us online, feel free to use the link in the chat or the blue donate button online to make your offering. And so let us now continue in our worship of God through the giving of our tithes and our offerings. us pray. Ever-present God, just as Jesus promised to be present among us when we are gathered together in his name, be among us now, that these our gifts of time and talent and resources may become instruments of your love and of your justice. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you. I'd invite you now to take a moment to share a sign of Christ's peace with your neighbors. And of course, if you're with us online, please do so in the chat.
Peace, bro.
Peace.
Of God, go out in peace, have courage, hold on to what is good, render to no one evil for evil, strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, help the suffering, honor all people, love and serve the Lord your God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship and community of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. And let all of God's people say, Amen.